my topic is about the challenge of becoming a data-driven organization. So I'm interested in why is it challenging for organizations to become data-driven and what can we do about those challenges? So the talk is based on my own research that I've done in the past. Also, it's informed quite a bit about research I'm currently working on with my collaborators. I also do education work in this space. So I get to talk to a lot of people across different kinds of organizations that are dealing with this very problem. So, and my thinking is actually also influenced quite a bit by those conversations that I've had. So the backdrop of this presentation is the observation that while we have increasing opportunities for using data in organizations, so this is largely due to digitalization, most organizations actually struggle to make good use of those opportunities. So we have many organizations that we can kind of name as these sort of shining examples of data-driven way of operating. So digital platforms being one example. So digital platform use data to not only as part of their product, but also to inform decision making about how they can make their product better. So booking.com, for example, conducts yearly thousands of experiments online to learn, collect information and learn how they can improve their service. Or we have companies like Tesco, a retailer, which pioneered the use of loyalty card data to generate customer insights, which then can inform a wide range of decisions from marketing to deciding on what to do about competition. And then we have companies like Moderna in the pharmaceutical industry or Lemonade in the insurance business that are trying to reimagine the core operations of their respective industries through data and AI. And we could go on with this list and come up with other examples of data-driven organizations, but the fact of the matter remains that most organizations are not driven by data. And this is not really because of a lack of trying. So companies and other organizations are increasingly putting money and time and effort into becoming a data-driven organization, but they struggle with the transition. So that is something that I'm interested in my work as a researcher as well as an educator. So how can we help not only the pioneering organizations go even further in the sort of technology frontier, but how can we also help the average organization, so to speak, to make use of these technologies? Because if we think about this problem from like an economy point of view, so the economic productivity will increase when we are able to move the big mass of organization toward using these technologies. So that's something that's kind of interests my own work as a researcher and as an educator. So to give you a little bit of like how I approach this, I don't look at this as a technological problem. So like if I look at this as a technological problem, I would think about the tools that we use. How can we make the tools better? And that's very important. I'm looking at this more from the point of view of the organization. So what is it in the organizational side of things that makes it difficult to become an organization that utilizes data in their decision making and in their operations? And if you look at organizations, there are multiple different options in terms of how you approach this. So you could look at organizational culture, you could look at institutions. My approach is a behavioral approach. What a behavioral approach means is that we're interested in the mental processes of people in the organization as an explanation for what happens in the organization. So that is a, kind of like a psychological way of looking at organizational behavior. A person who takes a behavioral approach to the study of organization is usually interested in things like information processing, attention, motivation, decision-making, learning, and using those kinds of concepts and to understand how the organization operates. And that is then the basis for understanding what might be the challenges for in becoming a data-driven organization. One of the foundational assumptions behind this behavioral organization theory is bounded rationality. Bounded rationality is basically just the term which describes the situation that we're not perfect in terms of our cognitive ability. So there's only so much information we can process. There's only so far into the future that we can look ahead. There's only so many options that we can consider simultaneously. So that's bounded rationality. And that's, of course, on the surface level, that's the very reason why we want to become data-driven, why we want to use analytics, because the promise of data analytics is that it helps us extend the bounds of our rationality. But it turns out that bounded rationality also has quite profound implications for what organizations look like in general, and that can actually help us understand some of the challenges that organizations have when they're trying to become more data-driven. So I want to talk a little bit about couple of things that organizations might face as in terms of as challenges when they're trying to become data-driven. The first problem is the hammers and nails problem. The hammers and nails problem describes the situation where we have people who have problems in the organization. So those are the people who want to drive down the nails. And then we have people who are expert in the data area of things. So these are the data analysts, the data scientists, the data engineers who know all about the technological side of things, but they might not have a good understanding of what are the most valuable use cases for data and analytics. So that's the problem we have, is that we have these people who have very intimate understanding of the problem. So these are the salespeople, marketing people, customer service, operations, HR, all the people who are dealing with the problems and issues of the organization. But then they might not have a very good understanding of what are then the technological solutions to this. Now, this is a very natural outcome of specialization because we are boundedly rational, so we cannot comprehend very large problems. So what we need to, what the organization is essentially a solution to the problem of bounded rationality, so people specialize. But the side effect of specialization is that we get these siloed expertise and siloed knowledge, and that can become an obstacle when we're trying to come up with useful use cases for data and analytics. Then a related problem is that actually, if you take any organization that's not data-driven and you start finding out what could be good applications for data here, you might not find good use cases. The reason is that when organizations are initially founded and when they initially grow, they do so without any data. They do so without any analytics. So they learn to live without analytics. They learn to live without the data. So when you then come, someone who knows all about what you can do with data, you might not find very good use cases. So if you think about, for example, a canonical in the area of marketing, if you think about, for example, customer lifetime value modeling, so you try to predict how valuable different customer groups are to the organization over time, you need to then, once you have the model in place and if everything is working correctly, then you need to create new organizational routines that actually makes use of those predictions. If you don't do that, then the model is just going to sit somewhere and it's not going to be useful for the organization. So in order to have useful use cases for data and analytics, what we need to do is that we need to change the organization somehow. So this usually means creating new routines in the organization, changing old routines. So the organization doesn't have just sitting around a bunch of data science problems that you can go ahead and solve. You have to first invent them, and then you have to oftentimes change the organization to make it more hospitable to data and analytics. But then you get into these traditional problems of change management. So whenever you change an organization, you run into all kinds of problems. People resist the change. People might leave because they don't like it. All the time organizational change is happening, people get frustrated with that. So you want to change the organization to create this, useful use cases for data and analytics, but that's challenging. It might also be that people's professional identities become jeopardized. So when we say to people that, hey, now we're going to do this using algorithms because they're better than you, then that's going to be a real threat to the professional identity of people in the organization. Or you might need to change incentives, because the way in which it's kind of optimal to work around when you have some predictions in use, it might be different from what we did before. You need to change the incentives. So you get all the change management problems when you try to create the use cases for analytics. And that's a big sort of a challenge that we have when organizations try to do this. And this is a big sort of landscape of problems. I think one sort of general idea that we need to take in this is that somehow we need to bring the data and the problems closer together. So we need to bring the people who know about the technological solutions and people who know about the problems of the organization somehow closer together. And this is, of course, a very sort of a general statement, so I try to unpack this with a little bit with a couple of examples. So one idea, how you kind of bring these closer together, is accessible analytics. What I mean by this is that the people who are close to the problems would be able to go and look for the data for themselves. So we have these concepts such as self-service analytics, where people in the organization can, for themselves, look for the information that they need instead of going through some data analyst or business intelligence specialist. Now, this, of course, conserves the time and resources of the analytics team, but there's the secondary benefit of this is that people then can start, they learn about the data that the organization has, and then also they can perhaps start reimagining, like, what could this data, what other problems could I solve with this data? As a complementary thing, if an organization wants to become data-driven, I think it's important that people across the organization have some degree of data literacy. So the people have an understanding of what is, in theory, possible to do with data. This doesn't mean that we train people to become statisticians or we train them to become data scientists. This means that we try to help people to have at least a conceptual level of understanding of what are the possibilities of when using data. So if a company wants to be AI-driven, my sort of suggestion would be that all the employees in the organization know what supervised learning means. Not necessarily to train the models themselves, but at least to have some sort of rough understanding of what that means. Because if they have that kind of understanding, they're better able to think about how could the data scientist in our organization help us. Can we articulate the problems that we have in a way and have more meaningful communication with the technical specialists? And then thirdly, I think it's very, very important, is the importance of domain knowledge for the analytics experts. So the people who have the technical skills should spend a lot of time and effort learning about the organization and about the problems that people in the organization have. So they should go around in the organization talking to people and trying to learn what their problems are so that they can think about what are actually the most useful use cases for analytics in the organization. And similarly, if an organization goes and buys some analytics consultancy services from the outside, I think it's a good idea to look into that consultant's expertise, not only in terms of the technical side of things, but also in terms of have they served similar organizations in the past? Do they have experience of your industry? Because that knowledge is actually the critical part when you are trying to figure out the useful applications for data analytics. I just want to conclude with this sort of a general observation about the pace of technological change and organizational change. So the reality is that technology always changes more rapidly than organizations. So there's all the time new technologies coming and going, and organizations are relatively slow to change and adapt. This applies to technologies related to data, but I think it applies to other technologies as well. And oftentimes, like I just discussed with the case of data analytics, you actually need to change the organization in order to create the useful use cases for the new technology. Now, the implications of this is that whenever there's a new technology, there's usually huge initial excitement about the possibilities, and then there's disappointment. This disappointment is just a sort of a natural outcome of the fact that technology changes more rapidly an organization, where we often need to change the organization in order to create the useful use cases for the new technology. So we shouldn't be so surprised if our initial attempts to adopt new technologies fail. So if you first don't succeed, dust yourself up and try again. All right, thank you.